as early career faculty, we're trained to walk the fine line of innovative research, but with assured success.
Raw City Fire, Raw City Fire, respond to the area of the Great Wall Restaurant.
Hey, I'm Victoria, and this is Cafe Creative, a video podcast series where I go out and talk to different instructors who are going about teaching in online environments in new and creative ways.
As a postdoc, I worked in a virtual reality center. And so I got my feet wet in beginning to understand how engineering, right, works very well with virtual reality and how we can use computation and visualization tools to aid us in the design, fielding, manufacturing, the entire lifecycle process for different systems. And so that joining S&T gave me the opportunity to continue to explore that idea.
Meet Dr. Benjamin Kwasa, Assistant Professor in Engineering Management and Systems Engineering. Dr. Kwasa has put together a research team that will explore how to help emergency responders, like firefighters, to conduct their traditional training operations in a virtual reality platform. He believes this will potentially help firefighters not replace their current operations, but enhance them. While we did conduct this interview before the COVID-19 outbreak in the US, Dr. Kwasa has confirmed to me that his team is able to move forward remotely despite the challenges.
So we reached out to the Royal Fire Department, and both the chief and assistant chief are very gracious. And so we started working with them in December of last year, December 2019.
We got here about 10 this morning. We did a walk through the building, took pictures, video, and recorded measurements of the room so we could recreate it in CAD. So we're gaining the knowledge of the building size so we can recreate a building that we can accurately compare to the computer model to a real world, and so we don't have to guess and, you know, small critiques of it.
They're also hoping to learn how the fire expands and grows.
Hopefully, the closer we can get to actual real life situations that they deal with, then the better the training tool that we're providing them to do their work. That translates into more effective firefighting, right? More effective emergency response in general. And ultimately, that's saving taxpayers quite a bit of money, right? In terms of loss of property and other events, right? If they're able to get to people who are trapped in a fire sooner, right? Then we're potentially reducing the health risks that are going to come as a result, right? Mm-hmm. If we're able to provide them a safe environment where they're not constantly being exposed to these gases that are generated during fires, now we're not only then improving, right, the longevity and health of our community members, but more so for the firefighters themselves.
There's a lot of potential. I think part of us partnering up today is to learn more on both ends, learn more of this technology, and I think it's a lot for Dr. Kwanza to learn where he can improve or what direction he needs to go. So this is kind of more like a research and development phase right now.
There's
so
a lot more to the setup and everything that we were kind of anticipating. We just thought, you know, kind of put together a building however they saw fit or what they were able to, and then set on fire and just go and try to put it out. But there's really a lot of kind of planning that goes in behind the scenes.
In the past, the fire service is always kind of piggyback from the mining industry. So self-contained breathing apparatus, stuff like that was developed in the mining industry and then kind of handed down to the fire service. So the fire service is being a lot more proactive in technology and kind of growing things they need specifically, not you know, just a dual purpose from another industry, but something that's more specific for the fire service in general.
That was surprising to me because I've never been around a fire that
big.
And you know, we were shooting, the camera was probably 20 feet away,
right? We were,
and the smoke just
and it like, just billowed out of the building, right?
I have no idea.
And so that was very eye-opening for
me,
right?
And because they're training in those conditions and all the time.
And I think the part that struck me most is that's in a controlled environment, right? Mm-hmm. That's when it was controlled. So you imagine them responding to actual fires in commercial buildings and apartment complexes, right? Mm-hmm. Where now you have other factors that you know, we don't even think about, right? One of the ones we discuss in the lab is the firefighter gets to train, right, in the structure, but there are certain elements that are difficult to train for, right, that mm-hmm. you then have to deal with. So you're reporting to a fire on campus in the middle of the day, right? So the parking lots are filled with vehicles that they have to maneuver around, right? You have 8,000 to 10,000 people walking around the campus, right? Mm-hmm. You have a huge multitude of people that are present in a building as they begin to evacuate, and these are all things that they have to interface with. How do we provide them that type of detail in their training platforms so that they can begin to think now about different elements of strategy that they usually had to come up with on the fly, but now can be more intentional about doing?
Dr. Kwasa's research is indeed making great progress through the on-site discoveries his team has been able to make since March. Speaking of team, in the next episode, I got a chance to speak with Dr. Kwasa about how he builds his team of research students and the unifying factor among a diverse group of majors. For weekly interviews, you can hit that subscribe button and look for us on Spotify for the audio version. Thanks, and I'll see you next time.